What's up, everybody? Welcome to IGN GameScoop. I'm your host, Damon Hatfield, and joining me this week in person is Tina Amini. It looks like she's far away. She's actually much closer to me than it appears that she is right now. She's joining me here in the LA studio here for Summer of Gaming and some other reasons as well. Mm-hmm. And then joining us remotely are Sam Claiborne.
I'm the giant head of Samuel Claiborne.
And the giant head of Justin Davis. Is awesome.
You should reach across for people watching the video, like make it look like you have a crazy long arm by reaching over through us and like touching. Can you get all the way over there?
There we go.
Yeah. You're slightly. No, stop.
Fine. Apologies.
We can move on. It's
for everyone that's listening to the show. Sorry. These are just video goofs that we're doing here. Tina is with me in the studio here in LA. Sam and Justin.
Nice to see those GameScoop graphics trotted out for the first time in a while.
Yeah, these are
take a look at them.
Longtime viewers will recognize this pixelated space graphics.
Yeah, those are designed for the last generation of consoles, so they look a little bit up-res right now.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, we remastered them previously, and we're going to remake them in a few years. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah,
GameScoop Part 1.
Yeah, Well, we've got a great show for you this week. So much to talk about. The Summer Game Fest happened. IGN's Summer Gaming Expo just happened. So there's lots of big games to talk about, some smaller indie games to talk about. We're going to get right into it. But first, this is going to be a bittersweet episode.
It is.
Isn't it? Because I'm sure many out there in Scoop Nation have already heard this is going to be Tina's last episode of Game Scoop with us. This is basically your last day of working with IGN.
Basically, yeah. I mean, because of the way summer events work, I'm kind of working through the weekend as well. But basically, And hopefully not last ever.
That's true,
I'm gonna have to crash some of the places. But yes, very bittersweet. I'm very sad to leave. I've really enjoyed 4 years at Game Scoop and four years at IGN. Sometimes it feels like I've been here so much longer, and other times, especially because of the 2 years of pandemic time, it feels
it's
been nothing. Just a blip. But you've all been so supportive, Scoop Nation, and Damon as well. Damon has been such a fantastic host and supporter of mine since the beginning days, and even entrusted me with the keys to GameStop a few times so that he could take some well-deserved vacation. So thank you.
And it went so well each time.
I mean,
no problem any time, especially that first time.
They were not Tina's fault. I'm not implying that.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Well, yeah. All of us were like very sad to be losing you, but also very excited for you in your future. Like you're not talking openly about where you're going.
Yeah.
But it's a very cool thing that Tina's going to go do. So
he knows some scoops. Yeah.
I've got the scoop.
Yeah, scoop master.
It's very cool. So very happy for you on that front. But you've been so awesome to have on Game Scoop. I've been hosting this show for 16 years now. A lot of IGN. Personalities have come and gone. You're one of the absolute best. Like, you made the show better. I think you made me a better host. I love it. You're always so well prepared, and you do all of your research.
My notes,
So it's been really great. You'll be irreplaceable on the show. I actually don't know what we're probably gonna have to cancel Game Scoop.
Shut the whole thing down.
This is it.
Yeah.
We made it.
No more video game podcasts ever.
Yeah.
It's
the only video game podcast.
The world's only video game podcast panelist is leaving.
Yep.
What do we do?
We made it 680 episodes.
Yeah, we got there. Is it 680? I thought this was 679.
No, this is 680. Oh. But technically, it might be 679.
Nobody's sure.
Nobody. Oh. None of us are counting, that's for sure.
Well, let's make the most of it.
Save 666.
Before we have to say goodbye to Tina, let's make the most of it. At least we've got some really big news to talk about.
That's good. Yeah, it's a good note to go out on.
We had at Summer Game Fest yesterday, actually before that, the Last of Us remake, the long-rumored Last of Us remake leaked and then was confirmed a short time later. And that's coming in September. There's some interesting things to talk about there. But then also today, another report has God of War Ragnarok coming in November, potentially. Yeah. This is a report from Bloomberg, and it's information that IGN has also heard.
Yeah, so we heard originally was going to be around September, which is interesting because now The Last of Us remake is going to kind of take over that time period for Sony releases. And and it should be, I guess I'm sure we'll get into it more, but are we talking about God of War now?
Yeah, let's talk about God of War.
Okay, let's talk about God of War. So November is what we're hearing, but as is Bloomberg and Jason Schreier, but who knows? Like, anything can happen between now and a couple months from now. That's the crazy thing about the wild world of development.
Well, I hope this is true.
Me too.
Because, even though we got some new release dates this week with stuff like Marvel's Midnight Suns, Well, we got...
We already knew Callisto Protocol. We got... Yeah,
well, we got that last
one. Yeah, week. Yeah.
But the fall was still lacking, like, a really, really big... Because without Starfield...
Exactly.
If God of War Ragnarok landed in November, that would just be an awesome, like...
Be perfect.
...holiday game. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we need something to play.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, still no one took... I joked about this today. No one has taken 11-11-22...
Yeah, that's
since
right.
Starfield, since Starfield left it open. No,
that cursed day.
If God of War took that, it'd be great. I want that to happen.
It would be great.
Maybe they will. November's in that territory.
Yeah.
Still time.
How do you, Sam, how do you feel about God of War arriving in November?
I mean, I couldn't be more excited to have a giant, big November game that everybody looks forward to. And of course, we always think about Game of the Year when we talk about a mm-hmm. big game that's a sequel to a previous game of the year, right? And so, you know, a lot of people have adjusted their kind of rhetoric around Elden Ring to be that's their favorite game of all time, or that it's the best experience they've ever played in a game. And so, you know, that makes it really interesting, because if people that, you know, originally it was like, I don't know how this is going to go up against God of War, it's going to be an amazing end of the year. But now that people are saying like, this is my favorite game I've ever played, like,
yeah,
I don't know what's going to happen. Like, God of War has an even bigger hurdle to get over in the sequel. Or maybe that recency bias will kick in. Everybody will be like, oh, I like how it's sure. more concise and has a better story. Like, who knows? It's just, yeah. I can't wait to see it play out. I'm going to be eating the popcorn in the GIF.
It's definitely, let's see. So Game of the Year talk is 6 or 7 months after Elden Ring, which is just enough time for like the backlash cycle to start. And then you're going to start to see message boards and Twitter threads about like, look, it's good, but I don't know. Like, the Sekiro bosses are better. Like, that's, we're weeks away from like all of that starting to kick in, I'm sure.
The inflection, yeah, right.
Yeah. That's so true. I mean, we've talked about recency bias on this show before too, and like how that can impact mm-hmm. Game of the Year talks. And we're all human beings, so we got to take this stuff into account, and you know, account for our biases, our inherent biases, which obviously, forgetting about games that were released in January, or remembering, or you know, having that mm-hmm. recency bias with games that might come out November 11th.
Problem solved. There's yeah. nothing released in January.
That's true. This year, that's true. Or like, you know, in Q1. Let's be yeah, general. Yeah. 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 But yeah, I mean, it's interesting for us because we start building a lot of the roadmap in October. So we got to hustle for those November, December releases to make it happen.
Well, here's hoping God of War Ragnarok does make it out in November. But that September spot is now apparently taken by The Last of Us Part 1 remake, which is a little bit of a puzzler to me. Like, I'm sure I'll play it, but I think a lot of people are just kind of like, huh. Like, even though it's been rumored, mm-hmm. just now that it's official, it's like, it's just...
Wait,
it's
not you're really
that,
doing that?
It's not that old of a game. It's on it's on PS4 and looks great.
It's been remastered for PS4, yeah. So yeah.
It's like... But
I thought a key point from that reveal... Well, if you have a more of an intro, you can do it, but I have a...
Oh, I just, it's just my regular BS.
Okay. You're just ranting. Yeah, well, let me interrupt your regular BS then, and then which is usually charming and wizened. But I think it's interesting that they in the announcement, Neil Druckmann talked about a different set of leads and kind of a different team working on it, right? Hmm. And he talked about, you know, this is also implied too, but like when there's a remake like this, it doesn't hold back necessarily companies from working on other stuff. So it's kind of like a, I don't know. It's just like, I think like they're clearly working on all kinds of exciting Naughty Dog games, but it's kind of amazing that they can do this at the same time. Cause it is,
yeah,
it is a lot of work, but it's not the full work that goes into a game. And it just means that they have, you know, on the business side, a game out this fall, right, which is exciting for them. And then for us, it's just kind of good news that they can do more development. I just think that's cool.
Well, they described it as rebuilding it from the ground up. Like we're seeing that in the footage right now. And I'm so curious what that means, because based off of the trailer and the footage that we've seen, and if you go to IGN.com, we've got a side-by-side comparison mm-hmm. between the remake and the remastered footage, the identical footage. So you can see it's mostly just lighting, colors, and then animations. But they say, theoretically, they're supposed to be I'm quoting here, modernized gameplay, mm-hmm. improved controls, and expanded accessibility options, as well as enhanced exploration and combat. So I'm curious what that means, and especially if they're talking about it as rebuilding from the ground up and remaking it. Like, mm-hmm. how much smoother is that going to be? What is exploration going to mean?
I definitely get the impression that that the cutscenes, right, are going to be like kind of one-to-one, but with the new models and new lighting and just 60 frames per second 4K. But the gameplay, I think my expectation is that it's going to be kind of more materially different. And it's The Last of Us 2 gameplay, but sort of in the world of The Last of Us 1 and all the improvements that came along with that. I was not like, I was kind of a hater of this project. I'm like, I don't need it. It's too soon. But then once I saw them side by side, I was like, yeah, okay. This looks really, it looks really, really good. Like in my mind, I was like, The Last of Us looks beautiful. It's gorgeous. I don't need to see it remade. But then like once you see those character models compared side by side, and I do have a really beautiful 4K TV now, then, you know, I kind of, after that first reveal, maybe I'm just a cheap date, but you know, it won me over from there. I'm like, I understand now and I get it.
Although it does still hold up and looks great. And I saw a lot of like our commenters in our community also saying the same thing, like, sure, it looks better, but at the same time, this just reminds me that the original and the remaster still totally hold up too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just want, I want 4K 60 FPS.
Sure.
Well, you're going to get it, Justin.
Yeah, even like...
I'm excited.
There's a side-by-side with the faces.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's from the trailer or if we made it or whatever, but like, to me, the faces in the remake don't look better. They just look different.
Different,
like
yeah.
A different interpretation.
Like different different details. Oh, and it's interesting because sometimes like Ellie's face in the remake looks grittier, like she's just been through some stuff. And then in other scenes, the remaster, she looks like dirtier and dustier too. So it does seem like more of a maybe incremental design decision, like maybe based on the context of where she's at in the story. Who knows? But all we've been able to see from the trailer so far is just the visual stuff, lighting stuff, details.
I thought it was an interesting point that they brought out the original, you know, voice or just actors, right? And they talked about how this is more the fidelity gave, and this might be marketing, right? But they say that like in this development process, they gave it a more accurate performance because of, you know, technology now, right? So it's like their faces and everything, you know, are kind of like up res, but then also like their performance should be a little bit truer because there's more facial musculature or whatever, which I think is like, I mean, that stuff's really interesting to me. And like, I love that behind the scenes stuff. It's really cool.
Well, it's even like, I'm curious to play it just as a curiosity, even like to see how it turned out.
Yeah, I mean, the biggest thing I'm curious about is because I really like the stealth gameplay and I felt like exploration was really cool because it tied in the narrative. Like you're looking for a ladder and you're having a conversation in the meantime. And like that makes exploration that much more valuable because if you let them linger, they'll just start commenting on things around them and extend some of the dialogue between the two characters. So I'm curious how they're going to amplify that. Yeah. Like that's the thing we weren't able to see.
What was your comment, Justin?
Oh, just two things. One, I don't love The Last of Us that much, so I'm surprised that out of the four of us, I'm the one most excited and most like jazzed about this remake. I really think it looks beautiful. But like one sort of counterbalance to that is that I am extremely bummed out and disappointed that it is $70. It just seems crazy to me. Hmm. You know, I know it's a remake. I know it's not a remaster. Like I understand all that, but I just. Like, come on, like, no one at Sony could convince them to be like, we got to release this product for like $50, guys. Like, come on. It just seems nuts to me to be charging full price for it.
Maybe it'll be a deal right after launch.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly, like, I'm disappointed that it's 70 and then it just screams like Black Friday bait, which is two months after its launch.
Totally. Yeah. It looks I didn't read this explicitly, but I see that there's, you know, DLC stuff in this because I played that DLC and it's fantastic and they show some scenes from it and the DLC is really good.
Yeah, they're selling it as a package, so there is that too. Cool.
I wonder if this remake would be happening at all if it weren't for the HBO show.
Yeah, because they also announced some details about the HBO show at the same time, so certainly from a marketing perspective it's like hand in hand.
If the HBO show is good, presumably a lot of new people are going to be introduced to this world.
That's true.
Maybe they're interested in checking out the game. They want to present the game in the best possible light.
Absolutely. Neil Druckmann also said specifically, like, I'm working on this show myself. And he made a claim that it was going to be, like, the most faithful adaptation, too, which obviously is a huge sensitivity for the games community. So if that's true, it could be, I mean, I loved the storytelling of the first one. So if that is true and it's going to remain faithful to it, I'm sure the show will be great. And I can't wait to watch it. But that is a very unique thing about that game that could show really well in a TV show. So I'm excited about that for sure. I'm really curious to learn more about it.
Well, that actually brings up like a little bit of a concern I have, which is like, I don't really need to play Last of Us for the story again. Like I am only excited to play it again for the graphics and the gameplay, right? Like, it's just like, I know the story. That's funny. Like when I hear faithful adaptation, I'm like, am I going to play this game a time again and then watch a show that follows basically the same plot again? Like, how many times do I need to see those zoo animal names redacted?
Well, I don't think it's gonna be that faithful. I think it's just gonna be faithful to the tone, the characters. Yeah, like I'm sure there'll be some side stories that we haven't explored, some context extra, you know, maybe additional characters that are interacting with them, but generally following, you know, the look and the feel and the atmosphere of everything. I think that's what they mean by faithful, not like scene by scene cinematics. Although that would be wild. I almost hope they do that just for the commentary.
Well, then there's also this The Last of Us multiplayer thing that they talked a little bit about, showed a screenshot, didn't provide a lot of details still, but it's something that's still being worked on, and I think they're going to talk more about it next year. So this is still a ways out.
Yeah, but that's apparently what we understand.
It's like big enough to be its own standalone thing that...
They talked about story and characters and stuff, so it sounds more like a Red Dead 2 online, Red Dead Online.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too, an RDO, like, which would be awesome. Do you guys remember the Funcom game... Secret World from many years
ago. Yeah, I never played it, but... Mm-hmm.
And then it was like rebooted at a point of time, but it had like huge aspirations for these different factions. So The Last of Us 1 multiplayer, because this is The Last of Us 2 effectively multiplayer, but becoming a standalone thing because it was planned for 2 and then they wanted to make it this bigger, ambitious project. And yeah, Neil Druckmann said it's as big as any of our single player games that we've done and in some ways bigger. So they're really selling in this. As a standalone experience. And what I remember that was originally promised about Secret World was the concept of these different factions and you kind of like impact the world.
Secret World B-roll?
Good job, though, honestly.
Amazing.
Every time. But yeah, the concept that they were selling was that you'd be part of these different factions and then, you know, coming up in different worlds and then having a different impact on the environment too. And then like highly competitive against like effectively other groups of people, AKA the other factions. So The Last of Us 1 multiplayer was factions based. Mm-hmm. You could play as the Hunters or the Fireflies. But a little bit more simple in the sense of like very unique for its own multiplayer experience. Like it's not a Call of Duty experience. It's very much a like scavenging horror survival thing, but with other players at play. And you could like loot boxes or loot chests, or not the microtransactional ones, just like in-game concept ones, and then craft items. So it was like very unique to The Last of Us world. So I feel like they'll take that, but it would be so cool if they can get into something like RDO Secret World-ish where there's just like big story missions and you're coming after other factions and you can maybe even like impact what maybe server by server, like you can impact what the environment is and what the other stories and missions you'll be doing. But that's just my like pie in the sky. Sure. Like, wouldn't it be cool if kind of concept?
Yeah. Well, I'm definitely curious to see, you know, next year, hopefully what they're doing with multiplayer for The Last of Us. And then they also just said that Neil Druckmann is like working on another game. Mm-hmm. Something else.
And then he made a joke. If anybody at Sony wants to leak it for me.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. Tough day. Tough day.
Okay. Some very welcome news we got this week. Something I've been waiting for a long time. A release date for TMNT Shredder's Revenge. It's coming very soon. Next week, next Thursday, June 16th.
Yeah.
Launching right into Game Pass. Which maybe that's
so rad. With...
What's that?
Yeah. Well, the thing that I didn't know if it had been out, did we already know it had 6-player simultaneous multiplayer?
That was a new thing that was announced this week.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, 6-player so cool.
Mode, Casey Jones reveal, and the release date reveal.
Yeah.
I love it. Can't wait.
And maybe it had already been announced it was coming to Game Pass, but that's news to me, and I think that's so awesome. I don't
know. Can any Turtles fan explain? I know images of Casey Jones, and I know that character of Bagley, but like, what is that from something that people like a lot?
Well, it's from...
I know it's from Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Is that like a cartoon character like that people care about?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's like one of the cool characters from TMNT. He wears a hockey mask.
He's like a toy and stuff. Obviously he's like, cool. What's the background?
He's like sports. He's into every sport.
Well, also, he's like a vigilante, right? And then he ends up just like teaming up with the Ninja Turtles to fight bad guys.
Okay. That's why he has like not only a hockey mask, but a hockey stick.
Yeah.
He's a sports fan.
So this is 100% a Damien game. I wonder if it's a Sammy game, because Sam likes games from the era that this game is based on, but brawlers don't always do it for you.
Yeah, I mean, they're just short, and you know, you get through them. If they don't have like something extra, I don't really see what really the appeal is. But I want to see everything in them generally, because like it's fun to watch. But like, if it ain't Castle Crashers with like this giant like overlay of like interesting, you know, leveling and grinding and character development, like there's just not much to it for me.
Well, you're going to be able to see everything.
Yeah, like it looks like it's fun to play through, just see like how cool these environments look rendered in pixels, and that's kind of fun, right? It's fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the couch play too, like playing with five other people. Like how many games give you the opportunity to do that these days?
Yeah, I'm very excited. Hopefully I can get
none
some
games.
I can get some play time in it before the next episode of Gamescoop. We finally got sort of a reintroduction and a release date for Marvel's Midnight Suns.
Mm-hmm.
Another bit of a curiosity for me, because during the Summer Game Fest, they showed another trailer, but it's just a cinematic trailer. Mm-hmm. They didn't show any gameplay. However, you can find gameplay on IGN.com
now,
because we have a preview of it. Our previewer played it for 5 or 6 hours, has lots of game footage, and I actually think it looks pretty cool. I'm like encouraged mm-hmm. by what I saw. That's why it's confusing to me that in the show, they didn't show that off. Because like this game kind of had something to prove. It was announced last summer, had kind of a mixed reception. It ended up getting delayed from its initial release date into the nebulous back half of the year. So it's like, okay, here it is. This is
time to shine.
Yeah, time to like tell everyone why they're going to be excited for this and when they can play it. But they don't even show the game. That was actually kind of a problem with a lot of games on the Summer Game Fest show. This one, Aliens: Dark Descent, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. Flashback 2. Well, none of these games showed any of their gameplay. That's right. Frustrating for me. I think it's like, if you're a game developer and you want to show off your game or you want to get people excited for it, but you're not confident in showing the gameplay, I don't know.
Well, that's the interesting like decision making that goes into these things, because they're thinking this is the big flashy like stage show environment. Yeah. So we want to show like Demon right. Hulk reveal. We want to show Spidey in the new suit. Like we want to show Venom and like Lilith coming and showing off some of her superpowers in terms of being able to like convert people to the dark side, I suppose. Mm-hmm. So that's the thing that like works well on the stage show. And they timed the embargo for the preview, which includes the footage. And I think it's the first time that we've seen like proper gameplay. I think we've seen like characters walking around the hub area, like the HQ area, but not really like the actual combat gameplay. So I think that they timed it in that way. So it was one of those situations where you get your stage show time and then people go online to places like IGN.com and find like the follow-up, the like deeper dive information. So, and I think that there's a little bit of a, I don't know, uphill battle for more mainstream gaming audience when it comes to card-based gameplay. Like, I know you're a fan, Damon, and we should truly all be fans after Inscription last year anyway.
I still haven't played Inscription.
Should have opened the door. Oh, you really need to play Inscription.
I know.
You really do.
Bring it to console.
Yeah, there you go. Switch would be perfect. But yes, it's actually really interesting looking. And the way that Liana Hafer, our previewer, described it was, because people just assumed like, oh, Firaxis is going to be XCOM, but with Marvel characters. But it's actually more of like, a tactical RPG with a lot of like relationship building and a lot of like ample quests to go through, side missions to do with other characters so you can build up your loyalty with them. So yeah, it seemed really seems better than expected. And yeah, now we actually know what it is if you looked at the previews anyway.
Yeah, you can see the little bits of XCOM that are in there mm-hmm. at a glance. You know, you're taking turns moving your units around a board
yeah.
and attacking enemies. But also at a glance in XCOM, you just have sort of like a group of similar looking soldiers.
Yep.
And now all of your units look unique and colorful, mm-hmm. and they all have different abilities. So mm-hmm. I'm interested.
And you could grab new abilities, like you could discover cards, and then level them up too. So there's just a lot of like extra progression in there too,
yeah.
on top of the XCOM movement experience.
So now Midnight Suns is set for October 7th. Justin, what say you?
I think it looks super, super rad. You know, Damon, to your point about a stage show, like I think if you're an action game and you're not showing off gameplay, that's somewhat sus. But, you know, they don't have a lot of time. Like they have a 90-second yeah. slot or whatever it is. And so it's a little tough to get into gameplay of a game of this style. Like even if you're watching the video right now, like what you're watching is like a cursor moving around and then a character moving around and a card plopping down. Like this game looks like it's going to be, and based off the pedigree of the developer, is I think going to be deeply satisfying to play. And I'm really, really excited about it, but it's not splashy in a way where you can like see at a glance, like what makes it tick. It's a game that you kind of have to sink yourself into and sink your teeth into to really get. But XCOM and XCOM 2, like, low-key, some of the absolute best strategy games ever made of all time, ever. And, you know, to see them taking on Marvel in this way in kind of a, I don't know, I mean, it's not like that bold or like crazy revolutionary, but they're not doing like the most obvious thing with it. Like they're clearly taking a thoughtful approach to what they're doing with these characters in this world. So, yeah, I think it's going to be rad.
Sam, how about you?
I mean, you lost me at cards. I think the
Inscription.
I think the character designs look awful. I think it's the worst Marvel game look you could possibly
Worse than Marvel's Avengers?
Yeah.
That game looked like they kind of took their characters and they're like, listen, we need to make them not look like the actors. Let's just move their eyebrows a little bit. And I think we're good. I think we're good, right? This game just looks like they went off of like their own idea of design, but it doesn't look like comics, which it could have, right?
Yeah.
And it doesn't look like Marvel versus Capcom or something, which like really stylized something to look awesome. Like Spider-Man's eyes just look bad. It's just like, what are you guys doing?
It's supposed to be like
Wolverine looks so bad.
Wolverine
looks embarrassing.
This is like everyone is typing. it's supposed to be like because Midnight Suns, the comic it's based off of, which I'm actually not super familiar with. I've just been reading about it. But it's supposed to be, you know, darker, and there's this injection of magic. Like Lilith is a magic based villain in this case. And so the costume design is supposed to reflect that and make it kind of unique in the same sense that Midnight Suns was unique in the Marvel series as well.
Yeah.
Allegedly. That's what I have heard.
Well, I like the Mortis animated Mortis snap that we've got
going. Yeah.
That's good stuff. Yeah.
The characters are the characters and their cards are just piles of stats. Yeah. They're just big stat
piles. That's
what
will make it fun for people.
Yeah.
And I don't care. Like after I've played the game for whatever, an hour, I'll turn off any single combat animation I can, of that flashy stuff. I'll turn it off, I'll skip it. And all I care about is two numbers crashing in together and seeing which one of those sets of numbers wins.
Somebody should make that game. That also cracks me up too, because I know a lot of people are used to watching XCOM style gameplay, and we all know what turn-based RPGs look like, but it is really funny to see a bunch of Marvel heroes standing and breathing in place like this. Mm-hmm. Well, like one person fires and wait a little bit more.
Yeah.
Another person. It's just like, I don't know. It's hard for me to suspend my disbelief, but that's only because I really like the Marvel movies a lot. I rewatched them all recently and I'm like super into them. And, you know, people are used to this complaint. Like the genericness looks weird. But in this case, it just looks off to me. And then like, I do like other Marvel styles. Like, trust me, I grew up reading Marvel comics. I love it. I just wish we'd choose one. I wish like somebody would be like, let's make this look like a Todd McFarlane Spider-Man era thing or something like that. Like it'd just be awesome. And it just never goes down that way.
Yeah, I do agree with Sam. I think the gameplay looks fun, but I'll admit that it's sort of generic looking versions of Marvel characters.
Well, look at the Spider-Man. Like, come on. Like, who does that for? And then Wolverine with the big fins on his head. Oh my God.
Okay. Another game that was announced yesterday with a cinematic trailer and with holding back gameplay until just a really, really short glimpse at the very end is Aliens Dark Descent. New Aliens game, cinematic trailer, and then the gameplay is like isometric, top-down, squad-based, and it was a little bit confused. Everyone was a little bit confused as to what it was immediately after the reveal. I found the game's official website, and then Tina found its Steam page, and there's actually more information there, so we actually have a clearer idea what it is.
Yeah.
But again, it's a situation where, like I think Justin was saying, a top-down sort of like, you know, it almost looks like a twin-stick shooter, even though I don't think it is. Mm-mm. Maybe people might be less excited for that than if they think they're getting a new first-person shooter Aliens game, right? But anyway, the developer is Tendalos Interactive, which is a French developer I'm not familiar with. They've made a few games that I had never heard of. But I do think Tendalos Interactive sounds a lot like the Weyland Yutani Corporation from the Aliens.
That's how they got the gig.
So the official description is, in Aliens Dark Descent, command a squad of hardened colonial marines to stop a terrifying xenomorph outbreak on Moon Leth. Lead your soldiers in real-time combat against iconic xenomorphs, rogue operatives from the insatiable Weyland Yutani Corporation, and a host of horrifying creatures new to the Alien franchise. And that last sentence gives me pause.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah. What is it going to be? Well,
what? So,
but you can't just have them shooting aliens, the xenomorphs, the whole time.
I mean, so...
They're going to breathe xenomorphs. Fire.
In this world of movies, there's just the aliens. Yep. And I admit, the prequels have kind of effed everything up. You know, like, in the original Alien, it takes place in the year 2122. All that all that far in the future. They had never discovered another alien creature until they discovered the alien. And now in this game, one of them is going to be like,
you're such a Grinch about like they need it's a twin, it's a shooting game. Like if something's moving over there, you just shoot it and then it explodes in a pile of goo and it doesn't matter.
That's true. And I think there's another part of the description where they're saying that actually whatever your command, because you can command your squad, obviously.
Yeah.
And there's 5 different character classes and a leveling up system. So you're like adapting what your strategy and your gameplay is and like what you actually have accessible to you. And then apparently the enemies will catch on to your antics. So if you use the same strategy, they'll eventually start to circumvent it and account for it. So maybe that's why they wanted to throw in a couple of other enemies so that it's like adds an interesting strategic dynamic of like, I don't know, maybe it's like flying xenomorphs, you know, like, I mean, I guess they can crawl on anything. So that doesn't really like make much of a difference, but it'd have to be a different kind of combat tactic there.
Apparently there's permadeath and you can customize your squad and then develop your base to research new tech and improve your squad even further. So like that, that sounds cool.
And not just permadeath, but a persistent world.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
But not just permadeath, but there's a persistent world. So you can, some of the strategy in each levels, you can find shortcuts, you can create safe zones, and then motion trackers that impact the level permanently. So like anytime you're unlocking these things or creating these new openings or setting up traps or whatever, that'll change the way that that level inherently permanently works. So that stuff is interesting sounding.
And then also it says, carefully manage your soldiers' health, resources, and sanity to avoid mental breakdowns.
So sanity effects.
I didn't read about the darkest bit.
Some darkest dungeon in there too.
Mm. So, eternal darkness too.
Yeah, in eternal darkness. So that sounds cool. I'll keep an open mind. That one's coming 2023. I don't know, Sam. What do you think of Aliens: Dark Descent?
Let me just say, I don't think I've played a lot of good Aliens games, but the Alien pinball machine that just came out is so good.
Cool.
You should seek it out and play it. It is awesome. It's like a Williams-era wide-body size game, so it's wide-body, and it has the best-looking... You can select Alien or Aliens, and you play games, you know, the modes are based on that, right? And so they have one called Find Jonesy, where it shows you several paths, and it shows the cat. The cat is Jonesy. Let me just get that out of the way.
Yes.
And it shows you, like, Jonesy's hiding in these places. But then all the lights go off, and so you have to remember where Jonesy was and try to, like, shoot that ramp, right? Or that passage or that loop or whatever. And then the lights will come on and you'll see Jonesy again for a second. Be like, no, Jonesy moved over here. You got to find Jonesy. And if you don't find Jonesy, it's really sad. Because Jonesy survives that. Jonesy is a survivor.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. For however...
Until Aliens, which I don't know. No, Alien 3. Alien 3.
Right? No. Aliens, she survives because she gets left behind at the beginning of Aliens. Ripley doesn't take Jonesy back to the, you know...
Oh, planet. Really?
Yeah,
I thought Jonesy was in the little pet carrying case.
Not in Aliens. Only in Alien.
In Alien, okay. So Jonesy gets to live out her life.
Apparently, she gets adopted by someone back on Earth.
Oh, that's a great ending. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. Jonesy lived happily ever after.
Okay. Well, this game, like, I don't know. I'll give any Alien game a try. I love the universe, and I think it's very easy to ruin.
I mean, everybody in the comments on our announcement, when we wrote up the announcement, was like, why didn't you just make Alien Isolation 2? Like, is that not what we want? And it was such a powerful entry in the series. And obviously, there's been many other missteps in the Aliens history. But I don't know. It's so much more interesting now that I've actually like read up on it. And it seems more strategic than I was expecting based off of the 3-second gameplay we got.
There are many more missteps.
This is an expensive trailer.
In the Alien franchise, there's many more missteps than there are hits across movies and video games. And
yet we still love it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, agreed. I think it's just the best design and the coolest. I mean, the Alien and Aliens are two polar ends of horror, and I love them both so much.
Okay, Sam, you have a list of some indies from this week that caught your eye, right?
Let's do it. Yeah, I do. So I watched the IGN Expo, the Devolver show, and the Day of the Devs, and a few other things. And just wanted to see like what stuff would stand out for the GameScoop crowd. So there's a couple themes here. The first one is going to be kind of games that I think this crew would like. They're gamey games, meaty games, I forget what we call Justin games. So let me go down the list. And I really encourage you to check out these trailers. I think we'll have some of them queued up. So the first one is called Plucky Squire. It is a game in which you're a little cartoon character that's in a book, and then you pop out onto like a very hyper real desk scenario, mm-hmm. right? And so you're going between 2D and 3D, like a link between worlds. So it's like platformy type stuff in a mixed 2D perspective with 3D. And I really like how it looks. It's like, as you explore this room, there'll be like a, you know, like, I guess like lunchbox thermos art and stuff that you're in for a little bit. And so it has that kind of like feel of that intense design that Cuphead has with, you know, kind of like platformy stuff. I don't know. It just like, it looks like designed as heck. I really like it.
yeah, I saw people talking about this.
Oh, you did? Okay, cool. Glad I'm not alone out there. That's Punch-Out reference right there, by the way, yep. that we just saw, too. Which, so clearly there's some retro game references. And here we'll see the character pop out in 3D, which is
cool.
Really neat.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Okay, so another game I like is called Time Flies. Now, this game is a, I think, a little bit of a... It wouldn't exist without Goose Game, because it has... It's about being a fly, or a series of flies. And it's kind of like a Goose Game parody, because each fly has... it's a time to live based on like average adult lifespan in different countries, but like reduced by a factor of 1,000. So it's like, you have 70 seconds to live. What are you going to accomplish in your life? And so like, what, you know, it'll be like land in a glass of wine and get drunk, or like, you know, collect a coin or something. There's a bunch of them. And then it scratches them off that same like little text list that Goose Game, Untitled Goose Game did, which is really, really funny. And I love, these are like, I would guess I would describe it as like Apple II graphics or like, but also it's kind of like Mario Paint, which has a fly in it, right? And I think that's really funny. And I think it's funny, like you can die, but you can also make these achievements by the levels. And I love it. I just think it's a really cool idea.
It makes me think of Minute, that game where each of your lives is 60 seconds long, and then you had to get a sword and like try to make it easier for your next 60 second life to progress through the game.
I suppose it's a type of rogue too, right? Because you're just like, you're learning in your brain what you do next. Soon. Wow, that was really fast. We just have the most amazing producer on this show. So another one I liked is Animal Well. So Animal Well is a game that it could be a Metroidvania. It's an exploration based 2D game, right? So a Metroid-like kind of. But what's cool about it is that like the designer described it as with 4K, you have like 1,000 times more pixels on screen. So even what you're seeing right now is a good example of that. Like it's pixel art with like amazing lighting effects and stuff like that. That is not unique or anything like that. I just think it looks badass and I love it. And I like how like the character's little and the world is big. And then there's also this hint at like puzzles being something that people had to work together to solve over long periods of time. I like that in Tunic a lot. There's like this kind of meta to Tunic that took a lot of work. And look at that map. I mean, come on.
Awesome.
We all love maps, right? It's great. So that looks cool. I'm going to give...
I like their scan line. They're like scan lines built into the graphics.
I know. You get so much fidelity that you could expose the crappiness of a
trippy
CRT television. And that's a cool effect too. Doesn't it look like it looks like well, I don't know what that's like. It looks like Super Nintendo. Okay, so Shim is an artsy Frogger game.
Finally, finally, art house.
See this?
Finally,
you're like a little you're like a little shadow creature that looks like a frog, and you need to cross streets and get around town and stuff like that. But it's like beautiful design. It just looks like super, super cool. So look up that one. And then one that I was supposed to write down the name of, and I didn't, and I'm so disappointed, and I feel really bad, but I loved it. But it was a game that was based on like an unpacking type idea, which, as you know, I love. But you put together puzzles with like objects in your house, and then a cat just comes and messes with them. Nice. So it's like, you're putting together these great, like, you know, like it's like arrange these plates or forks or whatever, but like there's actually like a little puzzle to it instead of it just being rando. And then sometimes this like furry little cat paw comes in, is like swipe and just messes it all up, which I love. I'm sorry I didn't look up the name of that game, but I think it's easy to find. It was in the Day of the Devs. And then three retro sequels I wanted to bring up just to be really quick about it. One is Flashback 2, which you already mentioned. We didn't get to see what it looked like. It was already announced, but we got to see a trailer and it kind of has a cool look. Flashback already looked cool. It just was awful to play.
Now they can make it actually playable.
What if they don't, though? What if they just go full Prince of Persia on us?
Yep.
Sam, was the cat game from IGN Expo, or are you talking about a different show?
No, it was from the shows yesterday. I think it was from Devolver.
Oh, okay. Because there's or,
sorry, it was from Day of the Devs.
Because we had a gameplay trailer of Gory Cuddly Carnage, which is about a from our story. A little cat riding a hoverboard and finally eviscerating evil unicorns in a sci-fi city was the snippet that we used.
Yeah, I watched
not that,
that
game
that
though.
Was a good one too.
But look at that! there it is.
I'll figure it out though after I stop reading through my notes.
Okay.
But there's also Little Nemo and the Guardians of Slumberland. This is ostensibly a sequel to the NES Little Nemo game, but like
which was a Capcom game.
Yeah, Capcom game, but also based on an existing IP,
well, yeah,
for
yeah,
lack of a better term. I think there is an 80s animated movie about Little Nemo, and then I think it predates that in comics.
I think it's an old-timey comic like books. Tintin, right?
Yeah, yeah, it's something like that. So somebody got the license to this and made like a pixel art Nemo game, but then you like watch it, and it's like the whole thing with Nemo, first of all, it's like the best music ever, and CJ famously never beat it at our desks. This is the game. Can the producer tell us what it's called?
Maybe he doesn't have...
Anyway, yeah, this is the cat game. But let me get back to Little Nemo, though. But thank you so much for finding this, and maybe we'll see a cat paw. But yeah, Little Nemo, like the idea of that game is that like you feed candy to animals, and then you can ride them, and it's really fun. So you have to kind of like solve these kind of platformy puzzles and exploration with riding animals. This game didn't really seem to have that at first glance, so I don't know what it is. Look at the NES games you stack.
Cool.
My kind of game, right?
It's like WarioWare, almost like short little micro games.
Mm-hmm.
The game is called A Little to the Left.
Ah, perfect.
Very sweet. Thank you so much, Red. And then the final one is one that I know is going to be a Damien game, or already is, and it's River City Saga Three Kingdoms. Damien, you want to talk about that one?
Yeah.
Cool. Well,
also, yeah, Justin, there's numbers smashing against each other in this one.
Oh, there are, yeah.
I can't tell if it's a straight River City brawler, but it's like set in feudal China, I believe, like Dynasty Warriors.
Romance of the Three Kingdoms style.
Yeah.
Does it have the same character style?
Yes. Well, there you go. So this looks great.
Isn't that insane?
It looks so good.
Yeah.
There's a lot of characters.
There's a lot of numbers flashing, and there's like, look at that. Oh, yeah. There's like zoom in. There's like zoom in summon attacks. Mm-hmm. It's great.
I love it. Anyway,
I didn't take notes for an indie minute, but I have a couple that jumped out at me.
Sure.
Cool.
On the IGN Expo today was Super Zoo Story, which is a Stardew Valley-like. Although it's very, like, so when I hear Stardew Valley-like, I'm thinking about like a pastoral, like chill-out game with good vibes. But this one's like so Stardew Valley-like that I'm like, I'm pretty sure that exact bush is literally in Stardew Valley. So it might be,
all that matters is that there's new romance options.
Yeah, I mean, I'm hoping that these are actually original assets and they're not from Stardew Valley. But anyway, like, this is my kind of game. But it's a zoo, right? So you're building a zoo and meeting people, taking care of these animals, and customizing your zoo. Like,
and they don't eat super, you.
And they don't eat you. Look at that penguin you feed.
Did you also see Bear and Breakfast in this genre?
Right. Yes, these pastoral games. I love that. Like, so first of all, I love Stardew Valley, but the thing that I doubly love about it is that it's so well loved by everybody else that now 5 years later, 5+ years later, we're getting to enjoy this renaissance of, these pastoral chill out games.
Absolutely.
Where, like, all I want to do in life is feed a fish to a penguin and then a heart appears above the penguin. That's it.
This is Bear and Breakfast.
Animals talk to you? Cool.
This is a Bear and Breakfast.
Different game. This is a different game.
Yeah, this is where you're interacting with animals and humans and trying to run a bed and breakfast or some type of business as a bear. And then look at the bear's walk. Isn't that great?
That's a really good walk animation. Damon, or anybody else, have you ever played Downwell?
I'm aware of it, but I haven't played it myself.
The developer of Downwell has a new game called Poinpy. 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 Yeah.
Cool.
And it's actually on, I don't know if it's exclusive to this platform, but the context that I saw the trailer and came across that game is it's a Netflix game where Netflix has had games for a while now. And I don't know if I would call the creator of Downwell's new game like a killer app, but I promise you that it's going to get me and many other people to check out Netflix games for the first time. And it's similar to Downwell, but now you're going up.
You're going up.
So it's Upwell.
Oh, yeah. That's a cat.
And so it just looks, it looks really, really good. And like, it's one of those games where if you're watching GameScoop, maybe this footage doesn't look like anything, but Downwell was just, it was perfect. Like, the game felt perfect to play. And like, that moment to moment, like, satisfaction of just like feeling exactly just right. Like I trust this developer.
Oh, no, this is Netflix.
Yeah, I'm very excited to download it and play it.
Is it out now?
Cool. That's a good show.
I don't know. I guess so. I don't know how Netflix games work. Like, is it on to download the app on my phone? Like,
I know like one of their games is on Apple Arcade, so it is possible that it's still the same for this one too.
Oh, cool.
I don't know in particular for this one. Yeah. This is new territory for them still.
Mm-hmm. Okay, man. Thank you for that indie update. Both lots of good stuff in
there. Seriously, good work.
Welcome. Before we move into 20 questions, Sam, do you have something you'd like to share with the camp?
We should do it after 20 questions.
Okay. In that case,
that's okay with you.
In that case, that brings us to Video Game 20 Questions. Our suggestion this week comes from Greg, who says, I was sad to hear the news about Tina. She'll be very missed as a regular on GameScoop for the past few years.
Thank you, Greg. I'm going to miss you, too.
Let the questioning begin.
By the way, Damon, did you see that there's a new Netflix Castlevania show?
Yeah, it's been up with Richter.
Yeah.
Oh, funny. So it's an actual Belmont, we know.
Yeah. And that probably means, like, if it follows the first season that bled into Castlevania 2, we're probably going to get Symphony of the Night. Jazzed.
I mean, then they'll have to bring Alucard back, you know?
There's also an animated era. Netflix Dragon Age, so which was kind of a surprise.
Wild.
Yeah.
How many years does that take?
There's like this much overlap between Rondo of Blood and then Symphony of the Night. So maybe, I mean, it'd be awesome if they ended the show that way, like right, just have them barely overlap with.
I mean, Richter, this is that. I'm not like deep into Castlevania lore, but that's like the same time frame, so it's totally possible.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Yeah, it's gonna be rad.
Is Richter in the beginning of Symphony of the Night? Is that why you're saying that?
That's how it opens. It ends up with him fighting Dracula.
And then, exactly. Yeah. And then he's in the... I don't want to spoil... Okay, I guess
is
it doesn't
matter. Is he the one that Dracula lectures about what is man and stuff?
What is a man?
Mm-hmm. Well, why do you play as Alucard then?
He reappears. It's a whole thing. Yeah. Okay. Richter's in the game later as well. So, he's a part of it.
I don't even remember all this.
Yeah. I just replayed Symphony.
Nice.
Anyway, 20 questions.
what were we doing?
Would you call this in a mini game?
Yes.
Oh.
Ooh.
Is it part of a series?
Yes.
I think it's Final Fantasy X.
It could be. It could be Borderlands. It could be Red Dead. Where do we go?
We already had the fantastic Zumbazis.
No, that's not what it's called. I actually keep forgetting what the name of that. Something, The Legend of the Zumbinis, The Legendary Journey of, I don't know. I forget.
Super Zim Wazzles.
Yeah. Zumbinis, that's the only part I remember.
Zambonis.
Where should we go with based off the ones I called out?
It's in a mini game, so you gotta...
Yeah, just lead the entire thing.
Is this from, was this on the PlayStation 2 era of games?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That doesn't quite narrow it down.
I think it does.
Is it a Final Fantasy game?
Oh, you do think it's, okay. So it is definitely.
What's the Blitz Ball? Is that what it's called?
Yeah, Blitz Ball. I was going to go with that too. Does it have Blitz Ball?
I think so.
Should we just do it? Record in five. Is it Final Fantasy X?
It's Final Fantasy
X. Yay!
I made it too easy for you.
Seriously. I love it.
Greg, how can
we shouldn't have done we already you, mentioned Greg. This game when we had mentioned three games.
Yeah, right off the bat. Like we just say it could be Final Fantasy X. Did we already mention those games?
Greg said, if she'll be on one last GameScoop episode, I'd like to suggest picking one of her all-time favorite games for a last round. He said, I hear a few suggestions from what I've heard her mention on some episodes of some of her favorite games. So he gave Final Fantasy X. Could have also been Portal 2, Inside, or The Last of Us.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Those are good ones. But yeah, Final Fantasy X, I mean, I don't know if I've told the reason why Final Fantasy X is such a personally impactful game for me, because it's not the best Final Fantasy game. I've just played this thing several times, and, you know, you could, like, go and replay cinematics in one of the hub cities because they were just so gorgeous at the time, like, just so incredibly artistic. They don't look terrible, but they were really, like, very different for the time that it was released. But yeah, I had a very personal experience with it. You know, I was going through spinal surgery at the time and very limited in my mobility, but you know, I had this whole big grand world to explore, and I was very focused on all the little details you could do, which is why I love RPGs in general. But like, you go and you get your ultimate, I forget what they're called, legendary weapons for each of the characters. And that in itself is like a whole journey and a whole quest. And there's tons of these moments where you're just interacting with people. And like, I don't know, it's just an incredible all around narrative, characters, cinematics, like all the little details you can do and all the customizations that come from all the new armor and all the things that you get too. It's just very cool, very good experience.
This doesn't look bad for a PS2 game.
Kind of, yeah, right?
2001.
Yeah. And then crazy. They did an HD remake. They re-released it for the Vita when that was a thing. And I replayed it when it came out on Vita too. Just any excuse, really.
I've never
played. Did we even mention that there's an FF7 stream next week where we might hear about FF7 stuff?
Well, maybe, but the stream's only 10 minutes long.
Ah, well, how much do you need? They only have 10 minutes of that game, man. You know it. Oh.
I can like hear the music, by the way, the battle starting music. Oh, yeah, like, we're not listening to it with the footage, but you see the glass breaking, the shattering impact, and I just remember exactly what it all sounds like. Love that feeling.
All right, so are you ready for story time?
Yep, story time.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see here. So, these are fake.
Yeah.
I'm going to read something here on Tina's departure. Mm. It's, I didn't write it. Bilbo Baggins wrote it.
Oh.
So here's the thing. All right. I'm going to set up this context here. This is from Fellowship. So at this point in the Fellowship of the Ring, Bilbo's leaving the Shire, and we know he's going to leave the Shire, right? He has his big party and he wants to leave. Now, unlike the first time he left when he was kind of forced out the door, and unlike Frodo's departure from the Shire, Bilbo wants to go. He has an adventure ahead of him, and he's like, I can't wait to get to this, right? That's a different context than the rest of the hobbits have on their journeys, right? And so that's why I think this was especially apt to read. So on his way out the door, Bilbo pauses and talks to Gandalf, and he says, well, I'll just read what he says. He says, take care. I don't care. Don't you worry about me. I am as happy now as I have ever been. And that is saying a great deal. And then he goes down the road and sings softly to himself in the dark. And this is what I wanted to read. He reads a poem that he wrote, or he sings to himself his poem. And it goes, the road goes ever on and on, down from the door where it began. Now far ahead, the road has gone and must follow. And I must follow if I can, pursuing it with eager feet until it joins some larger way. When many paths and errands meet, and whither then, I cannot say. And I thought that was an apt thing to read. We're all big Lord of the Rings fans for the context of people just tuning in now. And
I could also hear, nice, I can hear the tune of that poem.
Mm. Because I know, of the movie, Gandalf hums it at one point and then sings it later. Yeah. So,
well, that would be the proper send-off if you all hummed it together. Yeah, no.
We've been practicing our three-part harmonies.
Oh, that's very sweet. Thank you, Sam. Like, and very apt. And I'm probably sadder to leave than Bilbo was. So maybe not a direct comparison in that sense.
But what does Bilbo know? He knows he's going to see his friends again. Gandalf says at that point, hey, this is goodbye for now, but not forever.
Yes, I like that. Goodbye for now, but not forever. I'm going to use that as my sign-off.
But like Bilbo, Tina's going to live with the elves.
Which is just an incredible experience waiting to happen. And I feel like I'm going to learn a lot from that. So you really need to, grab life's opportunities as they come to you.
Yeah. Exactly. You want to see the mountains again.
Yeah.
The mountains, Damon.
Maybe I'll come back with a ring and wow you all with my speeches and my disappearing ex then, too.
At the very least, you can get rid of the damn ring.
I'll do my best.
Okay, Tina, long may you run. It's going to be, you'll be greatly missed.
But, likewise, to you all.
We'll definitely be, we'll be in touch.
We will.
Not going to be any strangers here.
Yeah.
And I assume you'll stay in the GameScoop Facebook group.
Oh, of course. Yes. I would, will be more active as well. I've never been much of a Facebook person, but I occasionally peep in there for Scoop Nation and saw all the really loving messages and really appreciated it. Honestly, I was just very overwhelmed. Did not realize that there were so many people that appreciated me on the show as much as you guys have said that you have. So thank you for that. And for a wonderful 4 years.
Yeah. It has been wonderful, for sure.
Yeah, we should wrap this before I get any more emotional.
Okay, we're gonna have like a little a party thing we're gonna
get. Yeah, yeah, that's really why we got to wrap and get out of here.
Okay. All right. Well, that is all the scoops that we have for this week. That is all the scoops that Tina has for you.
Yep. For a while.
But thank you to Tina. Thank you, Sam. Thank you, Justin. Thank you to Red with that amazing B-roll. Always very, very impressed. My name is Damon. This is IGN Game Scoop, and we're out.
And we're good.
Ooh. We good? That was so sweet, Sam. Thank you for that.
Okay, I'm glad you liked it. I was going to say, we can cut that out if you don't want that as part of it.
Yeah, that's my style. Damon, that was terrible. We got to No, that was awesome. Very, cool. Very apt indeed.
Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah.
Good cool show, scoop. Everybody.
Yeah, seriously. So,
really fun show. Wow, there's an old...
Oh, my God. That was my first podcast appearance.
That was the first one?
Yeah, it was beyond... This was like the introduction to me coming onto the show. Look how short my hair is.
Who's hosting then? Was Andrew hosting?
I guess so. Yeah. Maybe
Marty would have been hosting right now.
Yeah.
I don't know.
But yeah, man, blast from the past. Yeah, this was just like my introduction. Oh, yeah. That's right. My first day was Andrew's birthday.
Oh, so this really was your first podcast because it was the first day.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow. Oh, my gosh. Going on a podcast on your first day.
I know. Yeah. And I remember being like really nervous to join both Beyond and Gamescoop. And with Gamescoop, I was talking to Andrew about it. And I was like, I don't know. I'm really bad at trivia. He's like, no. 20 questions is not difficult. Don't worry about it.
Tina, when you were on Gamescoop, was that also during the time when we were in the audio only like little room for a little while?
No, I started video. Then we went audio only. So I was there for the transition to audio only.
The transition. Whole time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm, yeah.
That little hot
that
room.
Was short-lived.
So did you? All right. Well, guys. Sam, Justin, I wish you guys could.
I'm afraid to hang up,
you guys
everybody.
Were here. Seriously.
You'll have a great time this weekend. It'll be fun.
Let's take a picture of this little thing going on here. Yeah.
Here, I'll get my microphone out of the way.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I'm gonna take a picture of you taking a picture.
Hold on. Let me do it this way. There we go. Are you gonna take a picture of me taking a picture? I don't know how to do that.
I already did. I was so secretive about it.
Perfect. Yeah, mine too. So it's over here. Hold
on. I can put the glasses back on if I need to.
Oh, wait. I'm totally messing up this camera view, though. We gotta go in. Justin, I think yours is going to be better.
I'll give it a shot.
One more time.
Okay. Is it going to work?
There we go. Yeah.
Okay. I have no idea. Because I don't even know. It's going to be very silly, but I will send some around on Slack or text.
Seriously. Exactly. Cool. Perfect. All right, guys.
Well,
all
right. We'll see you later.
Yeah. You will.
Yeah. Great show. Great mini shows. Talk to y'all soon. Have a good rest of your day.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.